I'm going to talk about something different. It's not going to be fun or cool like music or virtual reality. So when I, got invited to this meeting, so I was thinking about what I'm going to show. So actually, I'm going to more emphasize on the applications of innovation instead of just innovation itself. So I think that's, at least in the medical world, it's also a very important part of the innovation. So China is a big country. So in terms of land mass, we are the exact same size as United States, but we have four times more people here. So that also translates into, almost for everything, we have a big number here. And so if we look at this disease side, look at those kids, they born with defects. So you can also see this is also very kind of, mind-boggling problem in China. So the overall birth defect rate is about 6% of newborns. And every year, so we have 17 million newborns in China. That translates into roughly 1 million newborns with birth defect. That means, so they have a problem at the beginning of their life. And we know a lot of newborn defects are caused by genetics. So these are the common genetic disorders, as I show here, like PKU or the other ones like G6PD or thalassemia. So these are caused by a single gene defect, and the other defects are caused by chromosome level changes. And I'm going to show you as one example is this trisomy 21, that's the downstream. So these are very common genetic disorders. So the question is, how can we have effective screening to avoid those defects? So before I do that, so I'm going to show you two examples from the other parts of the world to show you how they control genetic disorders in their population. So this is the first example I'm going to tell you. And this disorder, first of all, I need to review the genetics 101 here to introduce what is the disorder. So it's recessive. That means because we have each gene, we have two copies. We have two chromosomes, right, for each chromosome. So to have this disorders, two copies of the gene needs to be affected in this case. So I use this illustration to tell you how, what So how to get affected a child. In this case, both parents need to be carrier. So each of them carry the exact same gene defect. So after they get married, so that they have the chance, the 25% of the chance to produce affected a child in this case, as I showed on the left side of this girl. So this particular disease is caused by mutations in this gene. And so usually those kids, they will die before age of 5. And so this is a particular problem in Jewish population because they have a very high incidence of the carrier in their population. So this one out of three in this subpopulation of Jewish, that translate they have the 100-fold increase of the incidence, basically higher, 100-fold higher than the general population. So this plot is to show you the what they did and what is the effect after the genetic testing. So the dotted line is incidence in the Jewish population, and the solid line is in the non-Jewish population in the United States and Canada. And the axis here is the time, right? If you look at in the 1970, the incidence in the Jewish population is very much higher than the general population. But after the effective genetic test, and also the, you know, the carrier test, the consultation, and also the prenatal screening. So basically, they reduce the incidence, right, into just, you know, as the same as the non-Jewish population. So this is basically is a more like a random situation in their population. So this is one example I show you here. And the other example is this another particular disease is called thalassemia. Thalassemia is a gene defect in the hemoglobin genes. And this is actually very common. So roughly there are 200 million thalassemia mutation carriers in the world. And this kind of bell-shaped distribution, just to show you, they are usually in the subtropical or tropical region. And although we don't know what exactly why they show this distribution, but we believe it's related to malaria. So the carrier actually has some advantage to deal with malaria. So that's how they got selected and how, you know, these carriers are concentrated in the tropical and the subtropical population. And from this figure, you can also see the south region of China, like this place, the Guangdong province, Guangxi province, Guizhou, and Sichuan. So they have the high incidence of thalassemia carrier. And so those kids, if this is also another recessive disease, if both parents have the defects, so they will generate, they have a 25% chance to generate affected a child. Those child, because they have severe anemia, so they need blood transfusion to support for their life. And this example, just to show you how this particular disease was dealt with in this very small country, right? So we know it's in Mediterranean, it's also in the subtropical region. So they also have historical, they have a very high defect or very high incidence of this beta thalassemia disease. And this curve is about, you know, after the genetic screening, how the incidence was reduced. And the blue curve is what is expected in this population without any interference, without any genetic screening and genetic consultation, right? So you can also see there is a dramatic drop, so after the effective genetic screening. And then in this case, how this becomes so, you know, dramatically, or how this achieved, basically also the church got involved. So in Cyprus, if you get married, you need to go to the church, you need to get the blessing from the church. And the church will also support the genetic screening. So basically, if you need to get married, so you need to show your certificate about your genetic test result. So that's how this got enforced and how you see the incidence got reduced in this country. Okay, so now talk about China. This is basically what happened in Guangxi province about beta thalassemia. And so in this time period from 2010-2013, this is how many couples got screened, right? So there was a requirement to get a health check before marriage. So this is mandatory. And because the incidence of beta thalassemia is so high, so the genetic test of beta thalassemia also part of the health check before you get the marriage certificate. And so after the screening, so there are almost 1 million carried after the screening. And also there are roughly 100,000 so-called double positive couples. That means both couples are affected by this gene, by this defect. And later on, you see the other numbers indicate how many pregnant women got the prenatal screening, how many positive baby positive fetus was identified. And also this, by doing this screening and also the prenatal test, so the Guangxi province was able to reduce thalassemia from the number one severe birth defect to the number four birth defect. So that's the result from the screening, from this mandatory screening. So I'm going to talk about the other genetic problem. So so actually, this is quite common, you know. So you see these kids actually on the street, right? So they have a special this facial feature, and the problem is so we all have, as I said, we all have two chromosomes for each one, but this kid has three chromosome 21. So that's why the syndrome is also called the trisomy 21, as indicated by this karyotyping result. You can see three chromosomes of 21. So the conventional way to, first of all, I have to mention, this actually happens in a random way. It's not because the parents, as I mentioned, the other two diseases, it's not because two parents have some kind of genetic disorder. This happens, this trisomy 21 happens during cell division. So, and also it's a random event. So you don't have a specific population you can you know, go for it. And the only way to identify those cases is go to so-called high-risk population. So basically, age is the number one risk factor associated with trisomy 21. Basically, you just go to the you know, greater than 35-year-old woman to do this screening, because they are a high risk population. So the conventional way is you have to use an invasive way to get the fetal cells, because to do this karyotyping, you need cells. You need to have cells to look at the chromosomes. So you have to have some invasive way, either you get the, you know, fetus blood or you get some other type of cells from the fetus. So this is always the picture shown here. You have an ultrasound guided, you use a long, a big needle, right, to get the sample from the fetus. Again, this is a conventional way. So I'm going to introduce you a new way. Before I show you how the assay works, I have to show you this, the so-called next generation sequencing. This is about a massive parallel sequencing, you just sequence the DNA mixture. And you do parallel, you can sequence hundreds of thousands DNA molecule to get the sequence at the same time. And I use another number to tell you how powerful the technology is. So before we have the technology, the first human genome was sequenced by thousands of scientists and used roughly more than 10 years. But today, with just a powerful machine, we can sequence a human genome just in 3 days. So that's how you know the powerful is the technology. So with that, with this you know easy and powerful way to sequence the DNA, so now we can have this so-called this new test to detect trisomy 21. And we call this a non-invasive prenatal test because we only use mother's blood. And we get roughly 5 ml blood, and we sequence the DNA, those so-called cell-free DNA in plasma. So plasma has a collection of small fragments of DNA. Usually they are from died cells, so they release those DNA into the bloodstream. And for the pregnant woman, they also have a very small fraction of fetal DNA in their blood. So the blood placenta barrier is not very tight. They have a little bit of leakage. So the fetal DNA, these small fragments, can also go through placenta into mother's blood circulation. So now we get the mother's blood, we just sequence kind of everything in the plasma, every DNA in the plasma. And as I said, there is a small fraction of the fetal DNA. So after sequencing, so we just map all the short DNA fragment into human genome. We can see which fragment is from which chromosome, right? So if this, if we sequence the DNA from a normal individual, basically, you know, we will have the DNA fragments evenly distributed into every each human chromosome. But when the fetus has this defect, has trisomy 21, that means they have a little bit extra chromosome 21. So by doing this massive sequencing and mapping, so we can see a very small change, a very small increase, and this small increase is statistically significant, right? So then we can say the fetus has a trisomy 21, has an extra chromosome. Okay, just basically just come DNA fragments mapped to human genome, so then we can identify the trisomy 21 fetus, and with a great accuracy. Okay, so as I said, we have a lot of babies, right? So this is by March this year, this is how many cases tested in the world. There are three big US companies are doing this from Sequenome to Ariosa. These are the three US companies, and there are some other companies in China also doing that work. But we are the first one reached 1 million cases, 1 million NIPT tests in the world. And also because we have more babies, so now one day actually we do more than 2,000 tests a day for the NIPT test. So we are actually, in terms of volume, we are larger than the whole United States combined at the moment. Again, just because we have more babies here. And this is just to show you by sequence, more than a million cases. These are how many trisomy 21 cases what we identified, more than 7,000. The same method can identify the other chromosomal disorders like trisomy 18, trisomy 13, And also the other sex chromosome related disorders, like some individuals, they may only have one X chromosome, and some may have two X chromosome and one Y chromosome. These are all sex chromosome disorders, and also we can identify the other big changes at the chromosome level. And here, just want to show you the sensitivity and the specificity of this new assay. Okay, move on from the prenatal screening to tell you another story about the genetic testing in adults. So certain genetic disease, they have so-called late onset. They accumulate those issues and later on, you know, develop problems like cancer. So you know this movie star, right? I think 3 years ago she announced, right, she had her breast tissue removed. And 1 year ago, she also announced she had her ovary removed. So this is kind of, you know, for a young woman, right, this must be a very radical thing to do. And so why she did that? She has a family breast and ovarian cancer in her family. Her grandma died of breast cancer, and her mother, diagnosed as breast cancer, later on died of ovarian cancer. Her aunt also died of ovarian cancer. You see, she has a very strong genetic in her family about this breast and ovarian cancer. And she did the test and confirmed she has a particular BRCA1 mutation in her genome. So BRCA1 is a breast cancer related gene. So if there's a defect in this gene, so those individuals may develop ovarian cancer, breast cancer, or and also some individual develop pancreatic cancer. And so for that particular mutation, so they did the analysis based on the other patients, based on what's the impact on protein of this particular mutation. So they calculate the risk of, for her, the breast cancer risk is 87% in her lifetime. And to have the ovarian cancer, the chance is 50%. And if you put this number together, basically, you know, it's almost 100%. She would die, right, from this the particular gene defect. So now you can understand, right, why she did the breast tissue and the ovary remove at, you know, the young age. And this just want to show you. There are two genes involved in hereditary breast cancer, breast ovarian cancer, BRCA1 and BRCA2. There are very big genes. To sequence these two big genes, you have to sequence those fragments and put them together to learn where is the mutation. And also there's no so-called hotspot mutation. The mutation can happen almost in everywhere in these two genes. So that's why you need to have a technology to sequence every exon, you know, basically every base pair in this gene. So now we are using the next generation sequencing to sequence these two big genes more effectively. And the size of the gene is one, the two genes is one problem. The other problem is, there are many changes in your gene. Sometimes we just don't know whether they're related to disease, because there are a lot of changes in the population. They are very much neutral. They don't have, at least, you know, for now, we don't see any effect on your health or the other things. So we call they are non-pathogenic. And only the mutations, they are tightly related to disease, we call them pathogenic. And also certain changes we just don't know, we put them in the middle as unknown or likely pathogenic or likely non-pathogenic, you know, based on the degree of the impact on the protein sequence and also based on the information we have in our population. So this must be a, you know, daunting task, right, to sequence the gene, but also to interpret the result. And this result just show you the consensus we have between BGI and a lab in United States in St. Mary Hospital. As I said, for each variant, each, you know, the difference between you and the reference genome, right? So we want to put a score for a particular variant. We have this five category classification. This just want to show you, right, by using similar standards, we can get a very nice concordance between two individual labs. As I said, the annotation is not easy, right? To get this concordance, it's not easy. So that means with this concordance, with this confidence, so now we can do the screening in high-risk population. So here is, you know, we already screened 5,000 cases here, how many positive cases we have identified from the screening. So in the end, what I want to say is, you know, on the fun side, right, it's quite easy to apply your innovation. But for the medical applications, right, we still need to do a lot of validation. We still need to understand how effective is the diagnostic assay or a particular drug. We also have to know this, how harmful is this particular intervention. So that's the difficulty, right, we have to face if we apply innovation to healthcare, you know, to medicine. Thank you very much.